Watching Women on Fire. And the episode we're going to talk today is a continuation of a theme regarding letting go. In the previous episode, we discussed about letting go in the scriptures. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And this was looking into. So if you have missed that episode, don't worry. Just write down Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, and then you will take a grasp of what the Spirit of God was teaching us. So let's go straight away into verse 3, because verse 3 is going to show us the root of our insecurities, the root of our mistrusting that causes us to want to have control of situations, sometimes even control of people's lives, ministries, pastors. So, my dear beloved, so, my darlings, let's look at, without any delay, verse 3 of Hebrews chapter 12.
Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart.
Okay, let's see what verse 4 says.
In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood.
Can I read you the Amplified Version? Sometimes I read the Amplified Version because at the beginning of my walk with God, you know, my language, mother language was not English, so I had a great difficulty, and I'm still learning English. So anyhow, I didn't own a dictionary as such or concordances as such. I only had the Word of God, this one.
Amen.
So, well, I think all wisdom is in it, really.
Yes.
And the Holy Spirit can reveal everything there. But when there was a barrier language, and I used to hear, read, thou begat that, thou begat that, I said, what is that? So language barrier can be an obstacle. So I found that the Amplified Bible, in brackets, sometimes will expand a little,
yes,
explain a little. So it helped me. And sometimes I use several translations to get a clarity of what the Spirit is saying. So at this time, I think it'd be wonderful to use the Amplified translation to expand a little bit about verse 3 and 4. And it says like this. Just think of him. Who is that?
Jesus.
Think of him who endured from sinners such a grievous opposition and bitter hostility against himself. Reckon up and consider it all in comparison with your trials. Now it's getting juicy, right? So that you may not grow weary, exhausted, losing heart and relaxing and fainting in your mind. Verse 4. You have not yet struggled and fought and agonized against sin, nor have you yet resisted and withstood to the point of pouring out your very own blood, like he did. So isn't it so that sometimes we really go through bitter trials, persecutions, injustice. But sometimes there are things inside of us that God knows that only through that will be stripped off.
Yes.
And we were talking that the insecurities that cause when we feel tested, tried, and we feel that it's been injustice towards us. But you know, it's always somebody else's fault when it comes to us feeling like that. So for as long as we are looking at that person, it's their fault, they're unfair, they're unjust, they're treating me ill, and this and that. But look, I learned this in the world. There's three fingers pointing this way.
Yes.
There's
yes.
got to be something God is trying to strip out of us.
Yes.
That a big old self.
Yes.
All those insecurities that we took hold on to because things are not going the way we feel comfortable. Beloved, sometimes some terrible things happen in our lives. Really, injustice. Some people are even physically abused.
Yes.
Yes.
Sometimes some people come from households with alcoholic parents, drug addict parents, that send you to do things that you would never have wanted to do. Sometimes there are really injustices out there. And while you're crying and wondering where God is, Jesus is next to you, crying together with you. And sometimes all he's hoping is that you will turn around and call for him. He can save us. Not all the time, it's just God trying to strip pride out of us or whatever else. Sometimes there are really wicked things out there in the world that happen to innocent children and innocent ladies. Sometimes we choose our partner only to find out that it's not the right partner. It's not the partner that God wanted. But we didn't have a good relationship with God in the first place. We knew he existed, but oh, well, you know. And the decisions we make have repercussions.
Yes.
Yes.
So when we go and do our own thing, whether we know Jesus or don't know Jesus, there are repercussions.
Yes. Yes.
And we will suffer because of that. But it's not that God is punishing us. It is not God's fault either. But God can use all that to heal us.
Amen.
Amen.
To draw us to him.
Amen.
Amen.
To change the pattern of our lives.
Yes.
Yes.
And sometimes for us to realize that nothing and no one in this world is worthy to hold on except Jesus.
Thank you.
Yes.
Because you know what?
Yes.
I've come to this realization. I'm very happily married. I have the best husband ever who lives to love me like the Bible says. But he knows that I'm not the one he has to hold on to. I know he's not the one I hold on to. We both know that Jesus is the one we hold on to.
Thank
you. And the one we trust through one another. But some of us hold to our spouses more than we would hold God. We are so in love. We hold on to this boyfriend or girlfriend. And we completely despise and disregard the advice of pastors, mothers, fathers, uncles, brothers, sisters. And we marry only to find out we've got troubles.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the best thing is to learn to let go our own ways, our own decision. Hang on to Jesus.
Amen.
He's the only one who can.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So, we know that we have not died yet. We have not shed our blood in all those yes. struggles. God who shared his blood for us is strengthening us.
Yes.
So we can overcome.
Thank you, Lord.
And become
yes.
victorious.
Amen.
And become
Amen.
Stable
Amen.
In his love.
Amen.
And have our life renewed. I'm not saying if you're having arguments with your husband or your wife, you should go and say, you're not the chosen one, now I'm going to divorce you. I'm saying, if you have made a choice out of your own, repent.
Yes.
And hand over your spouse, whether the husband or wife, into the hands of God. Acknowledge
yes.
and take ownership.
Yes.
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 And ask God for help to let go.
Yes.
Yes.
Not let go through divorce. To let go
Thank
into
you.
The hands of God.
Yes.
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 Amen.
Let him decide
yes.
what must happen.
Yes.
And choose to love that person through Christ.
Amen. Yes.
Yes.
And choose to trust Christ in that person. And for your sake and God's sake, don't go bad-mouthing them, please. Speak only what is good. Only what is lovely.
Thank
yes.
you.
Yes.
Speak unto being what is not. How would you like your wife to be like? How would you like your husband to be like? Send it to God. Lay down at his feet and declare it by faith.
Yes.
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 That God will be honored and pleased to do something about it. Amen.
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 I want you to know that the things that we are discussing right now are things that are just being downloaded in our hearts, and it's things that come from experiences in our lives. Now, just to tell me, have you had to let go of something dear in your lives?
Absolutely.
Many times. Many situations, yes, of course.
Yes.
And I'm sure you have to you have had to let go many times as well. But if you're going through that situation right now, we want to encourage you that even in among the patriarchs and the people in the Bible, many had to let go in a major way. Shall we look? We see here in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 4. Somebody had to let go at something, and it was dear to them.
Genesis 12.
Are we ready?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Who wants to read?
I will read it.
From 1 to 4. Is that okay?
Yes. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram departed as the Lord had instructed, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran.
Not easy, right? So what did he have to let go of?
His country.
What
his
else?
Country, yes. His people.
His people.
What else?
Things he's comfortable with.
Household.
His
possessions.
What he's familiar with.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
I can relate to the scripture. You know, when I moved to Australia, I moved by my own free will, but I know it was the hand of God. So I had to agree. And I was pleased to agree. At that time, I was not in the Lord, but I know the Lord was in me.
Amen.
It's a difference,
Amen.
Isn't it?
Yes.
You might not be in the Lord, but the Lord is in you, working on your life. So, for almost 7 years, all I talk about are my family, my country, my everything, my mama, mama, mama. And I will cry in the Christmas time because all my family get together. And we used to shoot in the air, and we used to put all these festivities going on, and I used to miss it, and my soul was miserable. Hey, hang on. 7 years. I married about 6 months after I arrived. It was this love at first sight with my husband. And so 7 years I had kids. That's a long time to be pouching up your mouth in every festivity. Until the Lord, I came to the Lord and the Lord said, drop your country. Drop your tradition. Stop talking about the cuisine of Argentina. Adjust to the food of other nations. It's not all about Tuesday, like about your country, about your family, about everything. Let go. That doesn't mean you don't have to love them. You got to let go.
Yes.
You know, I used to get together with other South American girls and talk about our families and this and that. That's all we talk about. You know, so God was in the shell.
Yes. Yes.
And I'm sure that if you're Chinese, the Chinese are doing the same thing, and they go to Timbuktu and they want to eat Chinese food. And if you're an Indian, for sure curry in a hurry is on your schedule, no matter where you go. And if you're Islander, I know tapioca and all these things. If you come from Peru, the corn and whatever country you come, you bring wherever you go your traditions.
Yes.
But think of the Pharisees.
Mm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Reminds me when I had to leave Singapore and live in the Philippines. Oh. That was like back in the 90s. I was new in the Lord and it was terrible, terrible. It was like everything was taken off from me.
Yep.
Yeah, but I had to leave it because I have to follow my husband over. And at that time, being a new Christian, it's like I felt the Lord doesn't love me enough.
You see,
and it's like, you know, Lord, why are you deserting me and letting me, like, you know, go to this place where at that time it wasn't a very developed country. In fact, it was labeled dangerous, you know. But I found my footing somehow, okay, and the Lord gave me a word which has stayed with me all these years in times of trouble. The word that He gave me when I answered an altar call at the first church I could find there was like, my child, you're not alone.
Amen.
Though you may think that you're walking in the desert, okay, but the oasis is always with you.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
And that has stayed with me through everything that I go through. I'm reminded of it. Of course, years later, I had to go through another big crisis. But that word came back. It's like, I never left you, child. Mm. Yes, and I'm always, always there. So hang on to Him.
Amen.
Thank you.
Now tell me, when you speak about these things that were so painful, that you had to let go, and they were so wounding inside of you, how do you feel when you speak? Does your emotions rise up within it? Do you feel like, you know, still a little bit alive?
Right now, when I talk about that first experience, I don't feel the hurt anymore. But rather, I feel His love.
Because, and it brings tears.
Yes. It's like how much He actually prepared ahead for me. And it was in Philippines that I got to work with missionaries. I got
Amen.
To do a lot more of His work. I got to know a lot more about Him. And that was how my relationship with Him started.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
Wow.
So through all those things, it only brings back joy now.
Amen.
Yes.
Thank you, yes.
Lord. Of His goodness.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
You see,
yes.
There are two ways. If we have been healed by the Lord, our tears are tears of joy. We girls are so good at that, aren't we? We cry with joy and we cry with sadness, and people don't know what's going on. So, the tears of joy come from a healed heart that has let go of self and took hold of Jesus.
Yes.
But sometimes there can be tears where the soul still remains wounded. Yes. So, dear beloved, if you're going through this, if you're going through tears of pain and sorrow, even right now, we want to encourage you to lay down at the feet of the Lord. Let this pain go. Let the sadness go. Let it be an offering of love unto the Lord. And take hold of His feet.
Jesus.
We want to pray for you right now. So if you know that Jesus has been talking to you, if you know that this is your situation, whether you are a man or a woman, whether you are young or you are old, and your soul is aching, and your soul is being squeezed, and your tears are rolling from your eyes because the pain of the situation and the things that you are supposed to let go, I want to encourage you now, as if it was a piece of ragged cloth. Take it off you. It's like sackcloth. Take it off your shoulders. Give it to Jesus. He said He will take your sorrows and your pain. He said He will take all your anguish. He said He will carry your sorrows and nail it to the cross of the Lord. And from the depth of our heart, we release unto you the very grace God has given us to let go in our own lives. And we take hold of your hands and we cry with you, just like Jesus is crying with you. You have held on to that pain for too long. You have gone around the mountain for too long. It's time to let go. Father, you're the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. As we hold in the hands of our beloved brothers and sisters, it is not us, but Christ in us. It is your love. It is your healing balm. I pray right now, Lord, that every wound in their hearts, as they choose to lay it down, whether they know how to or not, whether they think they can or not, the moment they are choosing and saying, Jesus, I choose to let go, that you take over and do the rest. That you truly take over. That you will send your angels to take charge of these precious people. Lord, some of them, they don't know you. But this is the time that they will come to know you. Because you're the only one that can heal their heart. I pray that their souls, their mind, their emotions, and their will be healed. Forgive us, Lord, for holding identity in the pain and the sorrows we suffer. Forgive us, Lord, for taking hold of things that are not you. And for those that realize that they need a Savior, that they need somebody that will walk with them and help them and take their hand and show them the ways unto righteousness. For those of you, you can invite the Lord Jesus to take over, to be your Savior and your Lord. And as you do so, we know that by faith you are going to become a new creation. All things have passed away, including those ways of holding on to things of this world. Behold, all things will be made new in your life. I pray, Lord, that this is what's going to happen. This is what's actually happening to these people's life. You said, be whole. Make them whole, Lord. Make them one again. And heal their soul. Thank you, Papa. Thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name. Amen. My dear beloved brothers and sisters, if you have been blessed by the Lord, we want to encourage you to write to us. Let us know so we can be encouraged too. Look at the bottom of your screen right now and write to us onto that address. It's time for us now to finish with this episode, but we have hope to meet you again next week. So until we meet again, God bless you.